morning, and welcome to worship here at Salem Lutheran Church in Deerwood, Minnesota on this Sunday of Christ the King. It's good to have you here with us this morning. We're having a few power issues, as you can tell, so we're going to do this like they did it 100 years ago, by candlelight and by me shouting, and as long as the battery lasts, we'll even be on Facebook, so we'll do this together. So welcome to worship. Just a couple of announcements to highlight this morning. Today, Salem's budget meeting will follow this worship service, and you're all invited to come and review the 2021 budget. There are some copies of it on the usher stand in the back, as well as some copies of a sample ballot and things like that, so you can take a look at those. If we get power, you'll also be able to participate by Zoom in that meeting. Hopefully we'll have power. The 2021 offering envelopes have been placed in your mailbox here at Salem. If you have not picked them up, you can check that out and get your 2021 envelopes. The annual meeting of the congregation is Sunday, December 6th, 2 weeks from today at 10 o'clock right here in the sanctuary. The agenda items will include, but are not limited to, election of officers and adoption of the 2021 mission plan. So please plan to attend and be a part of that. Church Decorating Day is going to be Tuesday after Thanksgiving, December 1st at 10 o'clock right here at Salem. And you're all invited to come and help us deck the halls, and we'll probably have some pizza or something afterwards to celebrate the new season as we get started. Just a few people to keep in your prayers this week. LaVon Reeves has moved to the cities. Tina Royer continues to recover from surgery. Nikki Huber and Ryan Mole. And there are others that are, you can check your e-news for the others, but please keep all those folks in your prayers. Are there other announcements that need to be made verbally this morning? Don, come on up.
Good morning.
Morning.
I've been asked by several people to give an update on Honduras and what's happening there. In one word, it's horrible. But let me just talk a little bit about that this morning. For 20 years, this congregation has been deeply involved in helping the people in Honduras. Many of you have gone with me on mission trips. Many, many, many more of you have helped financially funding those trips, and we greatly appreciate that. The two back-to-back hurricanes have done horrible damage to the people of Honduras. The situation there is totally unbelievable. People living on rooftops, no food, no clothes, no water, no medical supplies, nothing. Can you imagine that? Think about going home to your house today and having to live on your roof with water up to your gutters. In January, I was planning on taking a group of 8 to 10 people on a mission trip to Honduras to continue building the homes that we started last year. I don't believe that's going to happen this year, at least not in January, but we are going to go. I'm not giving up on that. We are going. I'm just not sure when. The airport in San Pedro Sula, the city that we fly into, has approximately 3 feet of water inside the terminal. Airplanes out on the tarmac look like little islands. Everything is totally flooded. They've received approximately 35 inches of rain from each hurricane. 2 weeks apart, that's 6 feet of water roughly. This area, if you haven't been there, is very mountainous, a lot of valleys, a lot of, and the mudslides. I talked to Walker, the missionary that we helped build houses with last year. He was going up into the mountains where he figured there was at least 10 people buried in the mud. These hurricanes have hit, we've been going to Kids Ark for we've been going to Honduras for 20 years. We've probably been going to Kids Ark for 12. Randy Herring, the missionary there, is really feeling pretty low right now. 23 years of work is not all gone, but it's really a mess, and they just need our help. I'm going to read a couple articles to you. This comes from ABC News. It was printed yesterday. San Pedro Sula, shelters for people whose homes were flooded and damaged by back-to-back hurricanes, Eta and Iota in Honduras, are now so crowded that thousands of victims have taken refuge under highway overpasses and bridges. The International Red Cross estimates that about 4.2 million people were affected by the back-to-back Category 4 hurricanes in November. There's nowhere for the evacuated victims. They're piled up more densely in the northern Honduras city of San Pedro Sula, where some neighborhoods are still underwater. The evacuees say that they fear, even when they go home, that there will be nothing left. Orlando oversees a municipal shelter at a school in San Pedro Sula, where almost 500 hurricane victims have taken refuge. There are about 84 shelters across the city, holding as many as 100,000 people. There is a shortage of everything, he says, referring to water, food, and medicine. The situation also reflects the difficulty of sheltering natural disaster victims among the coronavirus pandemic. There is no room for social distancing. We are working against COVID, he said. But for the moment, evacuees are much more worried about obtaining basic necessities and dreading what they will find when they return to their homes. Rebecca and Jose and their five children have been at the shelter for about 2 weeks. We've been sleeping on the floor for 2 weeks. The children are sleeping on the floor, and we have been forgotten. Diaz is more worried about their home than the virus. I need roofing sheets, she said. I have no way to get a roof over our heads. Irma, a housewife, says her house in the village of San Juan neighborhood is still underwater. I feel the future is uncertain. We have nothing left. You work your whole life and to be left with nothing. What will we have when we go back? Nothing, she says. Still, there are those who are worse off. Many people, as I said earlier, are living under bridges and under overpasses. There are no bathrooms. People go up in the hills to go to the bathroom. People are dying here. They're hungry. The shelters are full. So what can we do? I received from Randy Herring, the missionary I mentioned a minute ago, a letter from him. This comes from Randy. Imagine what you would do if you were stranded on a roof of your house for a week with no food, fresh water. What would you do? For more than 20 years, Kids Ark International has been sharing the love of Jesus Christ with people of Honduras. Today we are joining others in a time of humanitarian need in the aftermath of Hurricanes Eta and Iota. They've dropped over 70 inches of rain on central Honduras. We are mobilizing food, water, and medical distribution in Jesus' name. Sharing tangible gifts can help turn people away from feeling hopelessness so they can begin to focus. So they can focus again on the task of rebuilding their lives. The residual aftermath of floodwaters and devastation often leads to routine cuts and scrapes, becoming infected, desperate people consuming contaminated food and water, the prolonged risk of dysentery, bacterial infection, and parasites lingering long after the water subsides. Hondurans will again have thousands of internally displaced families, forcing the government and the international community to start building refugee camps. These camps will be similar to those built 20 years ago after the Hurricane Mitch. That is why the need is so urgent today. We all might not be able to go, but we can all give. Kids Ark International is asking for your help today. You can be part of this massive humanitarian relief effort. In prayer, we boldly ask God to provide $100,000 this month in order to help those people of Honduras who are in dire need. In faith, we have begun sending seed funds. We have committed verbally to cover the cost of thousands of pounds of food, water, medical items, cots, cushions, blankets, towels, clothing items, shoes, sandals, and basic toiletries. Will you join us today in prayer for those impacted in Honduras by Hurricane Eta and Iota? We also appreciate donations to help meet the urgent needs of the Honduran people. We pray blessings on you and your family. Thank you for your prayers and generous donations to the Honduran people. So let's stop and think just for a minute. You know, our lives right now, we think, are kind of turned upside down. We can't go to our favorite restaurant. We can't go to our bar. We can't get together with our family for Thanksgiving. But yet we are so unbelievably blessed. We have so much. And as the Bible says, to those who have been given much, much is expected. You know, these people, there is no stimulus package for them. There is no unemployment. There's no PPP fund. There's nothing. They can't even leave their houses. I talked to Byron and Ruben this last week, two Honduran friends of ours that come and help us on these mission trips. They don't have a social security number, but they have a government ID. And the only day they're allowed to leave their house is when the government calls the last digit of their number. So the day my social security number ends in 9. When the government calls 9, that means I could leave my house. But where am I going to go? Am I going to go to the store where the shelves are empty? I can't buy anything because there's nothing for sale. It's a very desperate situation right now. I've set a goal for this week. Randy Herring's trying to raise $100,000 this month. I've set a goal to raise $10,000 by next Sunday. I ask for your help. No, I'm not asking. I'm begging for your help. These people need us. So please, go home today, think about where you are and how blessed you are and what you have. And, you know, $10,000 can be broken down very easily. It can be 3 or 4 people giving $1,000, several people giving $500, many people giving $100, and even more people giving $25 or $50. Whatever you can do, please do. Make that check out to Salem Lutheran Church in the memo, put Honduran Relief Fund, and get it either to Salem West, to Mustard Seed, or drop it off here at the church office by next Sunday. Please. Thank you.
We begin our worship by remembering not only how lucky we are, but how blessed we are to be part of God's family. And we remember that in the words of the confession and forgiveness. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates and redeems and sustains us and all of creation. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, you are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven, and by Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. Please be seated. Marie will sing.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
In our Bible reading this morning, because Israel's kings proved to be bad shepherds, Ezekiel declares that the Lord will assume the role of shepherd in Israel. The Lord will also set over them a shepherd Messiah, my servant David, who will feed and care for the people. A reading from Ezekiel chapter 34. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep, so I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the watercourses, and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. They shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring them back, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, but the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted at all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide, I will save my flock, and they shall no longer be ravaged. And I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them all. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And from Psalm 95 we read, we are the people of God's pasture and the sheep of God's hand. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to the Lord with psalms. For you, Lord, are a great God and a great ruler above all gods. In your hands are the caverns of the earth. The heights of the hills are also yours. The sea is yours, for you made it, and your hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For the Lord is our God, and we are the people of God's pasture and the sheep of God's hand. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The word of the Lord. Please be seated. Sisters and brothers in faith, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. A few years ago, a beer company, I don't remember which one, ran a series of ads with the slogan, smooth over everything. Do you remember those ads? A long time ago, but all. Nothing special about them. Except I always kind of liked the little symbol they put with the slogan. It looked like this. Let's see if I can draw. You can kind of see it? Smooth over everything. You remember those? It was kind of silly, kind of a stupid little thing, and I remember it, but I don't remember the beer that it was for, so that's probably why they pulled the ad. People like me remember this, but not the beer. Today is Christ the King Sunday, the last Sunday of the church year, and next Sunday we begin a new year, a new gospel, the Gospel of Mark, and a new season, Advent. And blue will be the color, and hope will be the theme. But today, on the last Sunday of the church year, we celebrate our Lord, Christ, as King, King over everything. And if you were going to make a drawing like this, a symbol for the slogan for today, Jesus over everything, what would it be? I thought of this. Maybe. Let's see if it works. Humble. That'd be kind of nice, wouldn't it? Jesus over everything? That sort of fits, yeah. or maybe if you're not into spelling but more into symbols, you could kind of put a cross over it. And you could do Jesus over everything that way. That would kind of work, I thought. Or if you're a student of Greek, you might make the symbol this way, using the first two letters in the word Christos, which was the Greek word for Christ, and put that, chi and rho, and put that together, and it could be Christ over everything, like that. That would work, huh? Let's see, what else could you do? Any others you can think of? I thought of one other one, but I'm not that good of a drawer. But maybe on Christ the King Sunday, we could use kind of a crown like that. And do something like that. That would be kind of fun to do on Christ the King Sunday. And maybe we could make a bumper sticker or a t-shirt like this, you know, so we could wear it. Or maybe we could do something like Ash Wednesday and get a Sharpie and draw it on our forehead. That would be kind of fun for Christ the King Sunday. What do we mean when we say Jesus is King over everything? I mean, it sure doesn't seem like the case when you look around at the world. Followers of Jesus exist. The church is pretty strong. But nobody would mistake Jesus or his church for king over everything. The Christians believe Jesus is king over everything, but it's just not apparent to everybody yet. And we look forward to the day when Jesus will come in his glory and gather all the nations before him and separate the sheep from the goats like a real king does. The day he will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end, as we proclaim in the Apostles' Creed. So what's it like? What's it like to have a king? Anyone ever lived under a king? Anyone want to? We live kind of in a unique time and place in human history. Most people in the history of the world have lived under kings and queens, and none of us have, I don't think. We've lived more or less in a democracy, in a place where each citizen has a vote, a say, in how things are going to go, and we value individualism and independence and majority rule. But that's not what it is like to have a king. A king makes decisions for you. A king is one who is served by his or her subjects, not the other way around. A king may listen to your ideas or may not. It's up to the king. A king may be good or a king may be bad. Either way, you've got nothing to say about it. Government is of, by, and for the king. Our ancestors who came to this country and who formed this country wanted nothing to do with kings anymore. They had enough of that. And they purposely created a nation without a king. Government of, by, and for the people. And yet here we are today, celebrating Christ the King Sunday. Jesus over everything. Do we really want that? The truth is, we don't want that. The story of God and people ever since Genesis is the story of God who really is king, and people who will do everything in their power to get out from under that king. Instead of trusting God, Adam and Eve wanted to decide good and evil for themselves and ate that forbidden fruit. Cain didn't like God's decision, so he killed his brother. The people of Babel tried to build a tower all the way up to heaven. I mean, they were going to be king up there. All of it in defiance of God. Jacob wrestled with God in the river. Pharaoh ignored the plagues. The Hebrews worshiped a golden calf, all in defiance of God. The truth about us is, we do not want any king, especially the King Jesus, over everything, over us. Our king is good, though. Our Lord sent leaders like Moses and David, prophets like Jeremiah and Ezekiel, to call his rebellious people back, always with kind of limited results. And finally, our Lord sent his son, and we did not accept him. In fact, we killed him. We murdered our king. What do you suppose is the penalty for murdering a king? I suppose it depends whether you get caught. And we got caught red-handed. It turns out that this Jesus really is king over everything. Death thought it had him, but even death could not hold this king, because he is king over everything, including death. This king came back from death, from his own murder, to his own murderers, to us, the ones who tried to strip him of his throne. And it turns out he is king over us too, whether we like it or not. The lesson lesson for today from Matthew tells about the day that this king will reign over everything, including you and me. All the nations will be gathered before him, Russians and Chinese and Americans, Mexicans and Brazilians and Salvadorans, Arabs and Israelis, Republicans and Democrats, rich and poor, healthy and sick, black and white and brown, Christians and Jews and Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists and pagans and atheists, everyone on earth, all of them there. All of them under this Jesus who is king over everything. And this king begins to do what kings do. He judges between the people before him. But this judgment is like no other judgment you've ever heard. The nations that we're used to, they compete with one another for power and for riches. The nations claim might makes right, and they prey upon the weak. That's the way the world has always worked, ever since Pharaoh made the children of Jacob his slaves. This one who is king over everything judges differently. He separates the sheep from the goats. The sheep go on his right. The king over everything says, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food, thirsty and you gave me drink, naked and you clothed me, sick and in prison, and you visited me." And the sheep, of course, have no idea, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or naked or in prison?" And the king over everything says, in a statement that sums up his entire administration, "As you did it to the least of these, you did it to me." That's a revolutionary way to run a kingdom. Not based on politics, not based on ideology, it's not based on wealth or power or religion. It's based on a king who identifies with the poor and the weak and the vulnerable and the least of these. And the goats on the left are noticeably nervous, and for good reason. The king over everything turns to them and sends them away because he was hungry and thirsty and sick and naked and in prison, and they did nothing. "But when did we see you? Just as you did not do it for the least of these, you didn't do it for me." And he sends them away to judgment, because that's what kings do. Do you hear? Do you hear how different Jesus over everything is going to be? It's a wonderful new world our new king will bring in. A world based on justice for all, including and especially the weak and the poor and the sick. It's not might makes right, but the bringing up to pass of the Beatitudes. Remember them from the King's Sermon on the Mount? "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall seek God. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God." It's a wonderful vision. But the story makes me nervous. Does it make you nervous? When I hear the story of the Last Judgment, I can find no reason to be considered among the sheep rather than the goats. Can you? In fact, it reminds me of all the times I have not fed the hungry and clothed the naked and visited the sick. And that's normal, I suppose, because even the sheep and the goats in the story are taken by surprise. What do we do with a king over everything who judges us according to his standards, not our standards. Nothing. If he really is king over everything, there is nothing we can do. The king's word stands. The king's judgment is final. And there is nothing you or I can do to change it. Nothing. So here is the king's final judgment on you and me. Listen. The king over everything said to you, child of God, you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. And water was poured on your head when the king over everything made that promise, so that you would know that the king was talking to you personally. And then the king said it again at the king's table, remember? The king over everything said, this is my body given for you. This is my blood shed for you. And when he made that promise, he gave you bread and wine so you could taste and swallow, so that you would know that the king is talking to you, judging you, yes. He knows that you and I are responsible for his murder, but then forgiving you. And by that forgiveness, making you and me his own. He is king over everything. King over death. Even king over you and me. It's not obvious when you look around at the world with all of its dog-eat-dog and survival of the fittest, but it's still true. Jesus is king over everything. And you and I are citizens of his kingdom. And we live our lives from this day on as citizens, as if Jesus is king. And the only response is, if we see someone hungry, we'll feed them. And if someone is thirsty, give them a drink. And if they are sick or in prison, visit them. It's not the way this world works, but it is the way our Lord's kingdom works.